Raise your hand if you would like to have a perfect memory. Me personally, I wish I had a perfect memory, especially when I have my exams. But some of the exams, like my biochemistry exam, I was so traumatized that I can't even forget it anymore. One of the researchers from 19th century, Luria, was describing a person in his book Mnemonist who could remember every single detail of his life. He could remember everything from early childhood, what he read, what he did, and what he was saying. You think that would be perfect to have a memory like this, but actually he was miserable. He hated having this perfect memory because all the memories would be so confusing for him. They would come to his mind all the time and he wouldn't be able to suppress them. And especially the memories that he didn't want to have. And to get rid of those memories, sometimes what he did, he wrote those memories on the pieces of paper and burned them, trying to forget, but he was never able to. On the other hand, did it ever happen to you that you were looking for that word and you just couldn't remember it? Or when you were talking on your phone and you're talking on your phone and you start looking for your phone, but you realize that your phone is in your hand? Or when you left your keys in that particular spot at home, but then you come there and they're not there anymore. Hopefully those are not early symptoms of Alzheimer, but actual normal processes of forgetting. And today I would like to discuss how we form, store, and forget our memories, and how forgetting is important for our memories as well. Hello, my name is Arsenii, and I would like to present my master's project on Alzheimer's disease and neuroplasticity. So what is neuroplasticity? I'm sure most of you heard the term neuroplasticity before, and what usually it refers to is changes, physical changes in your brain to account for your experiences. And it's not just that. Brain plasticity and neuroplasticity is actually everything that you can think of yourself as a person, all your experiences, everything is encoded due and thanks to the neuroplasticity. Neuroplasticity is what makes you learn new languages, what makes you learn this piece on the piano, and how long does it take you to practice. But at the same time, there is other people who would always go to the extreme to say how extraordinary those powers could be. And we always have to take it with a grain of salt. But in general, it's been shown that neuroplasticity can be very, very helpful in our life to not just remember, but have a better mental health and brain health. So neuroplasticity, to understand how it works and how we form our memories, we have to understand a little bit how our brain regions communicate with each other. And when we experience something, when I look at the cameras and I see them right now, the experience of all of this light and everything comes in my brain and lights up certain areas in my brain. Those brain regions communicate and they form a particular trace in my brain, the unique trace that represents this particular memory. And then later on, if I come back home and I try to remember that, I actually try to access this trace again and I try to remember what happened. If we zoom in a little bit more, we can see that the connections between those regions, those are the sites where all the memory forming happens. And when we look at these connections that are called synapses, when we think about this experience, when we repeat it or we do it several times, those regions fire again and again. And when they fire several times, they get strengthened. But like when we don't maintain those memories, when we don't maintain those connections, we forget them. We can think about this as a path. If you walk on this path every day and you maintain it, you will remember it and it will become a highway easy to access. But if you don't maintain it and you don't think about it and you don't study for your exams, most likely you're going to forget it and you're not going to be able to retrieve it after. To illustrate this example, and I encourage you to try it at home as well, I'll illustrate it with my memory from my childhood. When I was a kid, when I was around 5, I remember I was in this playground. I remember the details pretty vividly. It's a vivid memory. I remember the swing behind me. I remember the fence that was around me. And I remember this metal slide with a rusty old metal slide. For me, even for me as a kid, this slide seemed like a health safety violation. But what happened in my brain at that point, when I was looking at the slide, a particular region in my brain, the visual area, lit up. And it communicated with the rest of the brain, creating this unique pattern of activity that represented this mental health violation slides. So for other parts, for other details of this memory, I still remember, for example, the touch of the sand. When I was making this sandcastle, I remember how I was touching the sand, and I remember the touch of this viscous sand that I had in my hands. But then when I try to remember it a little bit more, and when I think about this detail, I don't really know if it's the sand from a year ago when I was on the beach, or it's an actual sand touch from 20 years ago when I was a kid. And here it gets a little bit tricky, because we can't really say sometimes when we try to look at those details, if those details are actually details of that memory or they overlap with others. And it makes sense biologically, because for our brain it's easier to store some details and distribute them over several memories, because it would save some energy for our brain. So this process is a part of process of forgetting, because most likely I forgot the part of the touch from 20 years ago and replaced it with the other. But to make a memory really memorable and vivid for me, for this memory in particular, one emotional part was very important. And what happened, this kid came up to me and he wanted to play with me. He asked me to play and build a sandcastle. But instead of playing, he just stomped and he ruined it. And I was upset. And that was my emotional regions of the brain that lit up. And those emotional response, that what helped to make this memory so vivid and so easy to access right now. Okay, so from this example, we can see that memory is not a recording on a cassette. It's not set in stone. It's actually its own entity that changes and develops over time. And how forgetting some of the details is important for our brain health. But is forgetting my postal code and forgetting when you have Alzheimer's is the same? Or do they have different mechanisms? And this is part of my project. That is what I'm trying to study as part of my project as a master's student. So to understand the Alzheimer's disease, first of all, we have to know the two main molecules that are considered to be crucial for progression of Alzheimer's disease. And those molecules are A-beta and tau. This A-beta accumulates in Alzheimer's brain in Alzheimer's patients' brains 20 to 30 years before the onset of the disease. And it is considered to be one of the causative reasons. But what does it actually do? What does this molecule actually do? And right now it's believed that this molecule helps to weaken those synapses and eventually forget some of the information, deleting some of the not wanted information from our brain. So if this A-beta starts accumulating more, if there is an excess of this A-beta, it causes more and more weakening of the synapses, and eventually it leads to synapse loss, memory loss, and Alzheimer's disease. The exact reasons why there is more A-beta in some people and why A-beta starts accumulate later in life are not clear, but it seems that it's an intricate balance between strengthening and weakening of the synapses. And if this balance is broken due to several environmental or genetic factors, if this balance is broken, we have the increase of A-beta and eventually forgetting and Alzheimer's disease. Okay, so if you thought to live until 80 years and you still have four friends, most likely one of you would have an Alzheimer's disease. To prevent it, there is things that you can do. And actually, the recipes were known for millennia. And only right now, research is catching up with those realizations. And the recipe seems pretty simple, but it's actually very important. It's to stay socially, intellectually, and physically active. For example, physical activity was shown to increase your level of BDNF, which is a molecule that promotes your brain plasticity and promotes growth of the new neurons in your brain. Even though I know this information, I'm not able to keep up my gym schedule. Or for example, intellectual activity. It's been shown that people with more cognitive reserve are more resistant to onset of Alzheimer's disease. So if you thought about this is exactly the time to pick up that book that you've been thinking about. Or the last but not least is stay socially active. It's been shown that people who have larger social circle are actually more resistant to have Alzheimer's disease and symptoms of forgetting, for example. So next time somebody invites you to a party, maybe it's not a good idea to say, oh, I don't feel well, and decline the offer. Maybe it's a good idea to actually go and get a bigger social circle. So party responsibly and work hard and try to use those understandings of plasticity and Alzheimer's disease to get your brain and mental health better. Thank you so much.